Ira Longini, I'm a professor of biostatistics at the University of Washington in the Hutchinson Research Center. And I work on analysis of infectious disease transmission and control from an analytic point of view. We work on things like influenza, cholera, TB, dengue, malaria, and so on. Well, it's a virus all of humanity is susceptible to, and that usually results in a pandemic that we see on average every 30 or 40 years, and we haven't had one since 1968, so we're due. And this is a new virus. It's transmitting person to person. As far as we can tell, it's similar in transmission properties as a seasonal H1N1 is, and it seems to be causing relatively mild illness at this point. But it's seeding the entire planet, and it's spreading person to person, and nobody has any immunity to it. Well, influenza has three modes of transmission, either, as you were saying, coughs and sneezes. We call that large droplet. And you know, people within about 3 feet or less of a person who's coughing and sneezing get covered with these droplets. Some are large and some are relatively small, almost like a fine mist. And that's probably the main form of transmission. Influenza also gets airborne, and with droplet nuclei, we call those. And it can float through the air and infect somebody on the other side of a room, for example, or in an airplane, several seats away from you. But that's probably less common. And then so-called fomites, or objects, where people leave the virus, such as doorknobs or tabletops. And that's probably less transmission through that route as the direct large droplet transmission. So all three, but it's mostly coughing and sneezing. We'll be coming forward with our estimates very soon, in fact, probably within days. But generally speaking, we're seeing a virus that transmits moderately well and very similar to a seasonal influenza. Well, it's a virus that's new to the human race, so we don't know what it's going to do. We have a few observations now, but we really don't know how lethal this virus is going to be or how transmissible it will end up being as it begins to spread throughout the planet. The Northwest, in terms of cases, transmission, the severity of the illness is very similar to the rest of the country. And the rest of the country is very similar to the rest of the planet. At this time of year, we're not in the flu season in the northern hemisphere. So we, at least historically, have never seen large-scale community spread of influenza in May through August. So we're not, at least historically, vulnerable right now, other than the sporadic outbreaks and small mixing groups that we're seeing. In the southern hemisphere, it's quite different, though. And by June or July, they're coming into their bad period of their flu season. It's their fall. And they could be quite vulnerable to this virus. There's many factors that create the flu season when we see these big outbreaks. Probably the main one is school opening. So schools and school children coming together in the fall and the schools opening seem to trigger these epidemics. In addition, the climate is cooler. People congregate more indoors and are more closely packed. With the use of heating, the nasal pharyngeal passages dry up, and that's more conducive to respiratory illness. So it's probably a combination of these things. I think we're getting the best data analyzed, which are basic person, time, place data. You know, where are the cases? What are their onset times? And for other exposed people in close contact with them, what happened to them? That's the most direct way to estimate transmissibility of the virus and to understand how it transmits.